we are in the same bubble for 4 weeks, very close. So we are sick together. Oh, wonderful that you could all come today. We are really excited. I think if we could put you in custody for 2 or 3 weeks more, we could tell you a lot of stories of the things we did the past 3 weeks. It was really exciting to work at ECOE. My name is Melle Smets, this is Joost van Donga. We go a long way back, and Joost became a scientist in his path of life, and I became an artist. And later in our lives, we made a joint venture here in Aardschap Foundation. I think I have to excuse myself for the difficulty of the name. It started as a Dutch company. If you would translate it literally, it would say Earthship. And it's not like a spaceship, but the Earthship means, you know, the Earth is where we come from and where we go back to. And as citizenship is, how do you Earthship? How do you do that? That's a bit where the name comes from. They gave me a stick. So we will do a short PowerPoint. And we want to take you to the informal justice court. As Fumi already explained, we did this experimental project together. And this is technology. So, not sure if this is going to work. Or do I have to go the other way? It's always something, no?
No.
Look, the informal justice court. As I just told you, we were for 3 weeks now in custody, or not really. We could go out every day in ECOE prison, which we cannot say prison anymore. It's now a correctional center, of course. And the reason we are now up to this stage started actually 3 years ago. So we have been around already for quite a while. But first I want to address why you go to a prison. And one of the things what we found out is that almost 50 million people in the world are on pretrial detention. And if you put that in your head, so that's not a Nigerian issue, that is not an American issue, that's not an Asian issue, it's actually happening all over the world. And for us, as an organization, as researchers, we are also very interested in, this is something nobody wants, right? This is not something anybody would wish for, but still, it's happening, and it's happening already for a long time. And for us, that's where the research started, like, how can, for a solution, in a very small, modest way, of course. And so we did that by choosing for Lagos, because the first time we came here, that was in 2018, we were actually invited by the African Artist Foundation, and we didn't know what to expect of Lagos. That was, we've worked in Ghana before, but Ghana is like a very little brother of Nigeria. If you come here, this is the real deal. So once we entered the city, for us it was also an open question, like, okay, what are the issues we can actually look for here? I'm sorry, this is really going slow. I thought we can speed it up. So if you talk about pretrial detention, of course, this is a very famous phrase of Martin Luther King. I think everybody knows it. It's also the title of tonight. So I already told you a bit about Aardschap, so we can skip this one. The moment we came to Lagos, we actually were feeling like this man. You can look around, but you don't understand what you see. If you enter the city, it's an overwhelming place. And we thought, how can we somehow start a research about this city? And how can you start? Where can we start? And that's actually where Joost, as criminology, set up, but why don't we go to a prison? Because in a prison, you will find like a microcosmos of the city. So that's what we did. We actually went by our own to Kirikiri. And we basically just went to the front door and asked, hey, you know, we are interested in researching the prison. And of course, you cannot just walk into the prison. Of the prison, it's not coming out very well. But this gives you an impression of what we do. So from our research, we start with field research. So we go to places like going to Kirikiri. We make maps to understand, okay, how does a place look? And so we really take it step by step. And next to that, we also went into, okay, so who is actually coming to the prison? How does the system work? So we found out that NGOs are very important. We also found out that the court system is mentioned a lot if you talk about pretrial detention. So all these places we visited, and of course you cannot go in as a tourist and make pictures, I started to make drawings as a sort of memorizing what is happening. And in 2018, it was great that we had the option, the possibility to actually be part of a football match in Ikui Prison. It was the final match between Block D and Block A, was it right? Yeah, convicts and pretrial detention. And I think the convicts won, right? Well, analyzing all that data and all the ideas and all the interviews we did, we finally started to map out and to visualize all the data we collected. Now, because this is going slow, I will not go into this too much. But basically, as a small example, these bottles are the people who actually went to the police to report a crime. This bottle is actually the crime that was handled by the police in a real case file. And these are, this little cup, are actually the people who are inside prison. And then a little drop of water, what is inside, are actually the convicts. So if you keep that in mind, that amount against a little drop of water, then you get a sense of how justice has been produced. Well, on the end, we started to make exhibitions about all the things we did. We did it in the African Artist Foundation. And that led over 2 or 3 years to a small community we framed around the research program. Here you see also a picture of researchers, people from the prison service, artists. And by doing this kind of joint ventures, it really gave us an oversight and a lot of inspirational talks in order to where are we actually talking about. Well, in the end, after 3 years, we went back to Europe. We started to also research in what is actually going on inside prisons and are there other projects we can relate to? Because what we are doing is maybe not something new. And we found about 25 great examples of restorative justice, of artists working in prison. But we, for now, just show you 2 examples, which are also the building blocks of the informal justice court. One is actually a court, which we do in the Netherlands and in America, where kids on a school have their own court. So they learn how to run a court, and if somebody is violating the rules on the school, you don't go to the police, you go to court, and your peers will give you a sentence. And a second idea we found, or phenomena we found, is from Cameroon, which was described by a man who did a PhD. Do you remember his name, Joost? It was a long name. Okay, doesn't matter, but there was a PhD who was describing how inmates did their own court, in an informal court, inside their cell blocks. And it was a way to relieve all the inmates from the pretrial detention period, that not knowing what is coming ahead was terrible. But in the informal court, the older inmates, who were much more experienced, could somehow say how long an average you would stay in prison, and that gave the inmates some relief. Well, combining all the building blocks together, we had, now it's running by itself. combining all the building blocks together, we discovered 3 main tracks. So one, pretrial detention is a very complex problem. Yeah? It's not something which is the fault of the prison system or the fault of the police. It's the chain of governmental issues, but also the growth of a city, a mega city like Lagos. Well, so, you know, it's endless if you combine it all. So you cannot solve it in an easy manner. And the second thing is that we found that self-organization is amazing in, I think, a lot of African countries, but here in Lagos we got so inspired by all the initiatives and how people somehow managed to self-organize themselves. So that we considered a strength. And the third thing is, of course, the legal uncertainty that people have. How do you deal with that? That's a big challenge. Well, and with that, we of course also thought, okay, but who is already doing this? Who's already working on this? And if you talk about self-organization, we immediately thought of theater. And we already met Professor Aziz, and he told us about his approach with theater and how you can help society by empowering people. So we thought, well, he could really bring in his knowledge to set up a program to help with self-organization inside ICUI. And the second was with the PILP. Of course, they are already doing this. They are already bringing pro bono lawyers to the prison. So why can't we do a joint venture and combine all the knowledge and the effort and the ideas to do a new experiment? And now I give the word to you. Shall I push in the meanwhile?
You can push.
We're both sick. It's difficult for us to follow the rules. Thank you for being here. It's a pleasure and an honor to address you on this special night. My name is Joost van Onna. And today we're going to talk a little bit about the Informal Justice Court. But you may be wondering, what is the Informal Justice Court if you're not that familiar with it? The idea is simple, building on the examples that Melda already gave. It's the idea that we construct like a moot court inside the prison where inmates act out their own courts, their own court cases. In this, what we did in this experiment, we also assisted them with the help of theater makers to strengthen them, to their posture, the way they talk, to gain confidence, to be able to defend themselves in their own criminal case later on when they go to the formal trial. And of course also by the legal expertise of the pro bono lawyers that participated in this project and who came to ICUI. We'll talk a little bit more about that. You already saw the Informal Justice Court in action. It's no more than a tent where we put in some chairs and some tables, because when you dress it down, a courtroom, of course, it's filled with symbols, but it is also a theater stage, right? Where people, a very serious theater stage, where people have to learn to speak up and to represent themselves. So what we did, what we wanted to do is to set up this court, but we also wanted to do more. Like Melle explained, we also are an action research organization, meaning that we try to make a change. In this sense is the court that we constructed. And we want to study that change to see, to understand what the problem at hand is, in this case pretrial detention, but also to understand whether this could function as a model to be repeated. So this is a one-off experiment, but why do an experiment when it could be copied to other prisons here in ICUI or in ICUI in Lagos, but also maybe in other states of Nigeria or even abroad? A pretrial detention is not a Nigerian problem, of course. So we had several aims with this project. The first one was to help inmates. Two parts in that. One, with legal assistance. You know, take control in their own legal matter, in their own case. But also very important to us, to help them psychologically. You know, they are not being heard when you ask them. They face very big legal uncertainty. You know, they don't know what they're facing. They don't know how long they have to wait. And we thought if we build a court like that, they can empower themselves. The second goal was to understand these complexities and to see if it's a model. And the third, and we will see there tonight a first example of, is also how can we make their voices be heard? Because like Nelson Mandela said, society should not only be judged how the rich are treated, but also the poor. And many poor people find themselves sometimes in prison as they cannot really afford a good legal representation. So we wanted also that their voices are being heard, literally later on in the program and through theater also later on in this program tonight. But how does the informal justice court work? How does the project function? So it consists of four stages. And the first stage is the selection of the inmates. So we drew a selection from the prison population in Ikouim of 80 inmates. All these 80 inmates, they received a pro bono lawyer. They were assigned a pro bono lawyer. And then we did a little interview with them and we asked them, do you want to be part in our experiment? If you don't want, it's okay, you get your lawyer anyway. That's not a condition. It's voluntary. They signed an informed consent to be sure they were explained their rights, that they know what they're participating in. But there were a lot of inmates enthusiastic about it. And then some time passed until 3 weeks ago when we came to the second stage, which is the training stage. And training stage means how are we going to explain to the inmates how an informal justice court works? That was not that easy, we thought. But as it happens, many of the inmates, they have been going to court many times because of some issues of adjournments, for example. So they are more or less aware of the proceedings, although they don't get the intricacies and the complexities of the justice system. They have some idea. But we, with the help of our partners, run through the steps of an informal justice court, which is basically just a simplified version of a Nigerian court case. And then we brought in, very important for the project, speakers. We had a magistrate, we had Professor Atsenua, who's also with us today here and has been part of this project since 2018. But also, for example, the head of community service to explain what community service could be, could it be relevant in their case, for example. And also we're honored to receive a prosecutor. And it was not only important that they explained their point of view, but they also were able to engage with these honorable speakers and to ask them questions. So after 3 days, they had a good feeling of what it was, and then we started the informal justice court. So we set up the tent, and what we did every day, we set out to do 15 cases. At the end, we did 18. So I'm very proud of our team that we managed to do so many. And what we did, we asked them first to give a short presentation of themselves and of their court case, because often there was no charge sheet, but it was also to inform the other people in the audience who would later take on roles, what is the case at hand. So there was first an introduction, and then we did the court case until the closing arguments of the prosecution and the defense lawyers, because we didn't want that the inmates would judge the inmate. So we wanted to do that in a group discussion. And in the group discussion, we asked inmates, what do you think of this case? You know, what would be a possible sentence? And then we would ask the lawyers, you know, what is this man facing if he would be found guilty? Right? To give an understanding for what he's facing and how long it may be until he goes to court. And in this whole process, the theater people and our pro bono lawyers were there to assist them. So they themselves, inmates, would take up the roles. And they would do the examination, the cross-examination, and the re-examination to train the defendant, for example, how to tell your story and what are the legal arguments that are in play in a real court case. And then the fourth stage of our project is the theater. We lost hope, and through this project we regained confidence. They learned a very important issue throughout the program is the issue of being open to your lawyer. Because if you, they mentioned, of course, in their own experience, several problems that, that may exist through the justice system, but I would single out two: police, problems with the police, but also they keep mentioning charge and bail lawyers. They really struggle with getting a good lawyer, so they were very enthusiastic about the pro bono lawyers they were providing because they were of such high quality. But gaining the trust, forming a bond between the inmate and his lawyer to be able to defend him properly, that was a really important thing that we learned. So let me close down by saying what we're gonna do next. I think that we can conclude provisionally that this project is working quite well. The inmates in ICOWI themselves have nominated their president, their secretary, and they are gonna continue this on their own. And we're gonna provide them pro bono lawyers. And there are already other prisons interested in this initiative. We're gonna write a scalability report that we're gonna present to the government, to the local authorities, to see how we can continue this. And which would be, for example, a way to fund this. And then, of course, very important, there will be a big play that we want to stage in ICOWI prison, but also outside ICOWI prison on the United Nations Day for both prisoners and prison staff, which is 18 July. And we thought that would be an excellent day to host this play. Let me give it back to Melle Swets.
Yes, thank you, Joost. So then we would like to finalize our talk also with a message from the inmates themselves. For us, it's from a very vital importance that we somehow bridge in the chain of people who are connected to the pretrial detention, that we also hear the voices of the people who are in the situation. Because we are talking now here on this stage about them, it would actually be better if we would also talk with them. So we do a small attempt, so we chose one of the many, many good examples or ideas that the inmates brought to us, and we put that on audio to listen to it. Sir, can you go to the next slide? Somehow you have to press this button. I don't know how do you do that.
Sorry. Good afternoon, everyone. For me, pro bono has been educative, informative, and revealing, opening up things that have been hidden to us when it comes to the judiciary and the justice system in Nigeria. But for the judiciary system, I would like them to pay attention to several things. Number one is the aspect of giving bail in court. Sometimes you get to a magistrate court for a simple case, you see a magistrate giving you a particular bail condition that you cannot even achieve, and it's not a capital sentence. So sometimes to be able to complete or perfect such bail takes us longer period in prison. Second one is speeding up trials, which are on several locations in the course of this program. I'm able to discuss with several lawyers, especially Magistrate Hakim and Kazim that came from Ikeja, that they should try and speed up trials, because the more the trials you speed up, the better it is for us here. I think it will help them decongest the prison faster. Then lastly is that we'd like them to also create programs. You know, I've been here since 2019. And I realized that there are some cases whereby an inmate leaves the prison and is found wanting again. He's back in prison. I've seen a guy who has been here like three times while I've been here. I realized that there are no rehabilitation programs that are being created out there for some people that have left. Now, we also have been here, we have several programs running, but we still need more programs coming in from the NGOs and government itself to be able to help us do better. So that when we get out there, we know we are more important and we are not neglected. Thank you.
So I think, if there's still an open solicitation for a prosecutor, then this is your guy. Because I think in 3 weeks he started from a very quiet guy in the corner of our court, and on the end he was really on stage. And had a very profound and good analytic mind to really also put other inmates on the spot.
Yeah, I think maybe we can appeal to the moderator tonight that maybe some of the issues he have raised could be a question for our panelists. I think we conclude our part of this evening.
Yeah, we should, I think, thank everybody a lot. Our team grew in also 3-4 weeks to an amazing group. I think in the beginning we obviously had to sort of find our way, like how do we work together, but I think in 3-4 weeks we became a great team. So thank you, Precious. She was there almost every day. Chooks, I don't know if you're here. Yes, there. Aziz, Segun, Tunje from the theater team. It was amazing how we sort of got a way to really work together. So we are very proud to have met you and that we can do this together. So thank you for that.
And please let's not forget Fumi Ayeni, who
of course,
was so busy organizing the Pro Bono Week that she was not able to join us every day. But we all know how important she's been for this whole project, and I hope also in the future. Thank you.
Team led by the able Professor Tunji Aziz. We want him to tell us something about the theatre performance.